Hello everybody, thank you for joining me in the class today. So today's going to be quite interesting. You may have seen on the net where people are doing artworks that are like three-dimensional. It looks like the real thing sitting on the table, but it's actually not. What it is it's called anamorphic art. So anamorphic essentially means distorted perspective. So it's an ancient technique discovered well over 100 years ago, but only sort of it was forgotten about, and now people are starting to discover it again. So what it basically boils down is when you're looking at something, the perspective is actually being distorted because of the angle that you're looking at something. To give an example, let's use that sheet of paper as an example. If I look at this and I'm looking at it flat on now, I'm seeing its full width and its full height. I'm seeing it in true perspective. That's exactly what it looks like. But the minute you see something from an angle, can you see its shape is changing? It now appears wider, or it appears narrower here. Let me rather put that correctly. It appears narrower here at the top. And all these angles, look how they're angling in. It's not upright like it was before anymore. The sides are tilting in. So that's where perspective is changing what you're seeing. So there's a way to trick your eye by distorting the perspective into thinking at seeing an object that's actually lying flat like this, to trick your eye into thinking you're seeing it that it's upright or at another angle. So let me give you an example of that. So yeah, I've got a printout of a ball. I didn't print out quite as nice as I would have liked to, but it looks like the ball is the correct size and the correct perspective, right? But that's just an illusion, making it look like it's a three-dimensional ball on the page, because by distorting the perspective, if you look at this thing from flat on, it's actually a long arm. I'm going to have to turn it sideways to fit it on the screen. So this thing's elongated like this by a lot. Let me put the real ball next to it. Can you see how much it's been distorted in order to fool your eye? And now to do this, you have to, the trick with it is that you can only look at this from exactly that perspective. If you move a little bit to the side, can you see what happens? The ball is now not round anymore, it's long. If you stand a little further back, or you're a little bit closer, the illusion breaks again. Can you see that? But when you're at exactly the right spot, and at exactly the right angle, then the illusion is complete. So that automatically tells you when this illusion is complete, that tells you where the person that created the illusion was standing. So that's in a roundabout way, a nice way to interact with your the guy that's looking at your artwork. So there are a few ways of creating these artworks. Now, obviously, I'm just using a printout here as an example to get this image as realistic as possible without having to spend hours and hours and hours painting a realistic tennis ball. But you could easily use anything. Besides a printout, you could use watercolor, you could use oil paint, you could use acrylic, you can use pencil drawing, anything. So that's a great opportunity for you to now create some artworks that are absolutely unique, because you may have seen a few of these kind of videos on YouTube and so on, but when have you seen something like this in an art gallery? Not often. I've never. So I have seen some anamorphic ones where there's a silver, like basically a silver rod or a round tube. And then there's a distortion, an anamorphic distortion around it. And then the reflection inside the tube shows you the correct picture. So the picture reflects inside that metal bar and distorts back to the correct image that you're supposed to see. So you'd have this long elongated image like this, you can't make out what it is, and then you look in the bar, it'll be a tennis ball or a dog or whatever the artist wanted you to see. I've seen one or two of those in a gallery before, but never something like this. So that's something unique that you could try. So I'm going to show you how to do it. Let's go to the overhead camera. And there you can see what it looks like directly from above. So I'm going to show you three ways of doing it. And the reason why I'm showing you three ways is because I don't know what technology you have available to you. And I don't know how clued up you are with technology. So I'm going to show you three different ways, and then I know you'll be able to, everybody at all levels and abilities can do it. So I'll show you, start off with the old traditional way, the way the guys originally figured it out. So I'm going to take a sheet of paper, and you feel free, work along. Hopefully you've got any object that you've got lying around. I'm going to use a tennis ball, but any object you've got lying around that will, if you stand from the side, let me go back to that side view again. If you stand from the side and that ball or object fits in on the paper itself, when looking at it from that angle, you can do it. Alrighty, so the first thing that you're going to do is you're going to take this piece of paper over here and you're going to divide it up into 10 pieces. So I'm using an A4 sheet of paper, so that's 210 millimeters across. So if I make a line over here and I mark every 2 centimeters, that's going to give me 10 blocks. Now I'm using 10 blocks. You can use any amount of blocks. It could have been 6, 8, 10, 15, 20. It doesn't matter really. What is important is that you just break it up into pieces. Then at the top of the page, you're going to make yourself a dot. So with normal perspective, and we did that perspective class just the other day, and we did 1, 2, and 3 point perspective. So in 1 point perspective, or any perspective for that matter, something is close to you, it's large. When it moves away from you, it gets smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. At some point, this guy is going to become smaller and smaller till it looks like a dot. And that dot will be on the horizon is when it disappears into a dot. So this little dot that you made at the top here is on the horizon. That's your vanishing point. So you're going to take all these marks that you've made over here. You're going to connect them with the vanishing point. So I'm drawing mine really dark with a pencil. You draw yours really light with a pencil. I'm just drawing them dark so you can see them. So the idea or the whole aim of what we're doing here is we are forming a grid in perspective. So it's the same as you've drawn just a regular grid. And now you've tilted that paper like we did at the beginning of the class. You've tilted that paper so that it's at an angle. And now you're looking at it at an angle. That's the whole idea of this. Okay, so when you're done, you should have something like that. So it's not quite a grid yet. There's still another step. But now the interesting thing is, let's go and draw just a regular grid. So I'm going to take another piece of paper. And let's draw a grid over here. So now, this grid, I'm going to make sure, has the same amount of blocks as the other one. In other words, this grid we drew here has got 10 blocks across, so I'm making mine with 10 blocks as well. Ten blocks in that way, and 10 blocks this way. Yeah, let's complete it on that side. Okay, so what I've created here is a square grid. I hope your grid's coming along at the same speed as mine. Alrighty. Okay, so there we go. We've got ourselves a 10 by 10 grid. We now want to recreate this grid over there. Let's do that so we can see both at the same time. So there's a little trick. On condition that you've created yourself a square grid, like there I've got a 10 by 10 block grid. So if I want to make a 10 by 10 block grid over here, then all I'm going to do is just judge myself any line over here. So let's take this guy and look at him in perspective. I'm going to tilt him towards you like this. See if I can hold it there. Okay, so this here is wider and that there is narrower as is pointing away, more and more away from you. So here, let's say, as we point this away from us, it ends up over here somewhere. Like that. So now we need to break this up into 10 pieces. So I'm going to do this. And just draw a line from here to the opposite corner. So do you agree with me if I do that over here, like that? each of these guys are going to intersect on the corner of the block because it's a they're perfectly square blocks. So the same thing happens over here. So you're going to just take this and draw parallel lines wherever the diagonal line crosses there. So that's just a little trick that you can use to draw your grid in perspective and get the perspective 100% correct. So as you're doing this, you'll notice something that's quite interesting. That these little parallel lines of yours, I'm going to draw them straight, these parallel lines of yours are getting closer and closer and closer together. And isn't that what's going to happen in perspective? Because things get smaller and smaller. So these little blocks will become smaller and smaller. Alrighty. So before we go too far, where you put this will depend on how much of an angle you are looking at the object from. So let me demonstrate that. If you're looking at something flat on, you're going to have I think let's look at the whole, let's maybe go back to this camera over here. If we use the whole paper because it's longer, it's going to give us a better demo. If you're looking at this guy flat on, there and there, it's equally wide, right? As I tilt this guy a little bit, this is now just a little bit narrower than there. If I tilt it some more, that, or this here, is even more narrower than there. Tilt it some more, this is even more narrower than there. So the more you put this guy in perspective, the narrower it becomes. So if you're looking at something from the top, it's going to look square. And the more you look at it at an angle like this, the more narrower this is going to become. So this is what we are doing here. The higher up along this sort of radiating lines you go, the more flat you will have to look at your object in the end of the day. The lower down you bring this, the more at a let's say for example a 45 degree angle or a more from the top you would need to look at the object. So don't draw this guy too low down, put him quite high up, because that just gives you a better effect when you have to stand a little bit back and look at the artwork. Alrighty. So now what we need to do is take your object and place it on your grid. So in this case, I'm using a real object, but you could just as well use a printout and a printed grid. So I'm just getting my printed grid here. You could just as well use a printed grid. So if you followed my Let's Draw course, you will have a grid like this. And if you haven't followed the course, if you go to the sales page, you can get this grid for free. And you just print it out onto a transparency. And then you can take a photograph that you've taken and put your grid over it and use that to create this. I'm just working from a real object today because that's what I've got. So what I'm going to do is just judge myself a circle over here. Yeah, I think let's do that. I will at least get. Something that's remotely round. Oh, wait a minute. I've got a much better idea. Use a lid, and at least it's an accurate circle. Yeah, there we go. Now we've got a circle. All right, let's say our tennis ball, let's put it with an interesting little zigzag over there. So I'm going to put that zigzag in. Something like that, almost like a yin yang kind of look. That'll do the trick for our tennis ball. Okay, so Malin is asking, how do I determine the distances between these horizontal lines? Malin, you've judged that or estimated this little furthest line over here. Then you've connected it with this diagonal line. Remember that? So wherever this diagonal line intersects one of these radiating lines, wherever it intersects, you draw a horizontal line. There it intersects, I draw a horizontal line. There it intersects, I've drawn a horizontal line. You see that? All the way up. So that way they'll automatically go narrower and narrower, like they should with perspective. And because I've done that, I'll automatically have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Exactly the same amount of blocks as what I've got over here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. See that? So it'll be perfectly square. So that's the only trick with this little diagonal line trick, is it must be, you must use a square grid for your initial drawing over there. All right, so when you're working with a grid to redraw something, you need to number it. So let's go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 across. We'll do the same here. So let's just erase that bit over there so we can write there. We don't need this top little piece anymore because all we're interested in is getting the grid lines. Like that. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And I'm going to do the same thing because I've got a long distance over here. I'm going to do it at the bottom as well. I find that when I've got using a big grid to write my numbers yeah, let's just call it that way. We're numbering your grid on the left and the right, or the top and the bottom, helps a lot. And you don't have to keep following lines. Is which block am I in, which number block am I in, and so on. All right, so across we've done 1, 2, 3. So down we need to do ABCs. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J. Let's do the same thing here. A, B. J is a really nice long block, isn't it? Okay. Now let's redraw that into here. What I'm going to do is just lightly erase those little boo-boo lines that I initially did, just so that it's not confusing. So we're only seeing the correct lines. Yeah, there we go. That's better, right? Okay, so the way I redraw with a grid is I start with any block. So let's say, for example, I'll start over here, and that's the furthest box out that way. I could have started there. I'll start anywhere that makes sense to me. where I could remember where I've started. So that's F in block box F2. So I think let me just, I'm going to do this. Let's see if I can zoom in on this box in another camera for us. Okay, so I'm going to start in one box there like that. So I'll say, for example, F2. And I'm going to take a look. Well, first of all, find F2 over here. And then I'm going to take a look, where does that line intersect in F2? So here it intersects just to the right of center. And then it intersects sort of on the third mark over there. So I'll mark those intersections over there. And I'm going to go all the way around. See G? Yeah, in G2, it intersects sort of a third on this line. And now as I go along to make sure I don't lose my place, I'm going to point to wherever I'm working. I'm going to point to it. So now I'm working over there. Tree intersects about there and just below or just above that line over there. So can you see what I'm doing? I'm forming myself a whole bunch of dots. The next guy, he seems to be nice in the center of that box. And no, just above the center, right? The next one is in the center, like that. Okay, let's move along there. So now we're going back up again. Seems to be sort of on a, yeah, around a third again. Got my old grid here from the side, so that's quite a mission for me to judge all these things. I'm getting back. Okay, so I'm just quickly running around here and I'm going to blot out all these little intersections. Okay, so now I'll just connect these dots. So now what I'm going to do is, as I connect these dots, all I see is from that dot, what shape, what path does it take to get from there to there? Is it a straight line? Is it a curve or whatever? And I'm going to just follow that shape. So luckily here we are working with a ball, so I know it's a reasonably smooth curve. So I can just follow that curve. Okay, now let's do that little yin-yang S. Alrighty. Okay, so let's go back to our overhead. And now I'm going to just use some acrylic paint. So I'm going to paint this. You could use a pencil to shade it in and so on. So what I'll do is I'll just use that as a guide of where to where to shade this guy, because you're not actually drawing it so that it's from that angle over there. So let me just, we do it something like that, eh? So that's actually what you're painting. So let's see, we've got our light coming from the right to the left, so it's light over there and then it's dark over there. and he's got a little bit of a shadow. Okay, so let's see, we can maybe use some crimson. So I'm going to do it really basic. Let's maybe use some permanent green light. That's a nice bright green. And then just for the purposes of today, we'll just do something really quick. We won't bother too much about perfect colors and shadings and stuff. I'm going to use some white to lighten. And to darken those guys up, I'm going to use a little bit of Payne's Gray. And then we can use Payne's Gray for the cast shadow as well. Okay, so let's say start with the red. Now what's really important is that you work quite accurately at this stage because things are elongated. Any mistake you make is exaggerated. Okay, so I'm just going to stay a little distance away from that line over there. And then we just leave that little centerpiece empty. Okay, let's darken up. Let's add that little bit of a shadow here at the bottom area, which seems to be in this area over here. So I'll darken up over there, and then I'll just fade him away as you normally would. So it takes a little bit of getting used to that. This is now, for example, a circular object, a ball, but he's looks long. But you quickly get your brain quickly catches the hang of it. All right, so now let's do the green. So again, I'm just going to stay a little way away from that center line. Okay, so we've got that, and he seems to lighten up here at the top. I'll pop in a bit of white over there like that. And he darkens lower down. Let's take a little bit of Payne's Gray, work some green into it. Not very dark, but just a little bit of darkness happening over here in this edge. Just like that. And I think let's clean the red brush. Let's mix a highlight for him as well. Just a little bit of a highlight there too. Why not? Okay, now I'm going to take some neat white. I'll just run it in here. That should be good enough. And now we want a little bit of a cast shadow. So let's take a tiny amount of this Payne's Gray. That shadow is just around here. But darkly against the object, and then it just fades away. It's good enough for now. It's not perfect, but it's good enough for now. It'll give us the effect. Okay, so now let's take a look at this guy from the correct viewing angle. So I'm gonna go, let's go to this view over here. We do that. So now you can just, at the end of the day, you'll now go ahead and just erase all this, get rid of your grid work. Because each of these guys is unique, you've got to find that sweet spot. There we go. Where is perfectly in at the perfect angle. And there you go, you've just created your first anamorphic artwork. All right, so that's the grid method. That's the method that was traditionally used to create these artworks. There are easier ways using technology. So I'm going to show you how to do this on the computer quickly. We won't physically draw that artwork or paint that artwork, but I'll just show you on the computer how I do it. So what you do is you take a photograph of the object that you want to create an artwork of. Now the big secret is that you've got to have a bounding box around that object. It could be, like in this case, I've put down a piece of paper. It could be anything. You could have drawn maybe a box around the object. So this is what the guys, when you're doing, say, street art, would do, because this is exactly the same technique that they use for street art as well. You've seen those, they've made a whole long street full of all these fantasy objects and stuff. They've given themselves a bounding box and they've created that artwork inside the bounding box. Because you're going to use this bounding box as your template. So for example, I've put down an A4 sheet of paper over here. So the first thing I'm going to do is just crop the image just to get rid of everything outside the bounding box, because we don't need that. That's just extras. So can you see even my paper isn't straight or nothing like that? It doesn't matter. Now I'm going to create an artwork or a new image that's A4 size. So I'm going to take here and I'm going to select A4 because that's the piece, the size of my bounding box that I created over, well, that's the size of the bounding box over here. All right, so let's just copy this guy. And we're going to paste him down in this new image. And now all we need to do is distort this guy until he fits our image. In other words, you're going to make this piece of paper that you've in the photo fit the in inverted commas the piece of paper you've created here on the computer. So the first thing I'm doing is just getting the height right. So I'm just resizing him down so that we've got the height of the paper correct, and then we just need to fiddle around with these widths and things. Okay, so to do that, you'll have an option to by your resizing, instead of just resizing something proportion and so on, there's one where you can say distort, and that allows you to drag just little corners around. See that? So I can change this image. I'm just going to drag these things randomly around here for now. So you sort of think of it as you can pinch and punch this little image of yours around until it fits. So that's pretty much what I'm going to do now. I'm just going to drag these guys around until that piece of paper fits. So it does take a little bit of coaxing, because as you move the left-hand side, the right-hand side also distorts with it. Okay, can you see there? So I've just dragged this guy until my paper is now exactly the same size as the image. So you've technically distorted your perspective, and instantly, can you see the shape of the ball is starting to look like the one that we've plotted out? So you're going to take this guy and you can now print him out onto a sheet of paper, and you'll end up with something like that. And guess what? Now you can take your grid, you can pop that on there, and you can now transfer this onto your canvas or your board, whatever you're creating this artwork onto. So here's now an interesting thing. The way we are taking photos of this is with it on the table looking from the side, but this could just as well be something that you're hanging up on the wall. So it could be an artwork that you've hung up on the wall, and now you've looked at that from the side. So at the moment we've got a table and we're standing over here and we're looking at that table like from this angle here, right? But it could just as well be something that's on the wall, and you've looked at it from this side. So you've distorting your perspective in that direction, so that when you're standing over here and you're looking at your artwork that's hanging up on the wall, you'll see it correctly. So that would then the situation where you could use something like that is you would now hang this artwork, say, in a corner. So you'll be sitting here on your couch and you'll always be looking that way at that artwork. So when you're sitting on the couch where you'd normally sit and watch TV, when you look that way at that artwork, you're seeing it looks like a three-dimensional object coming up off out of the wall. Okay, so in the end of the day, that's what I did over here. That's exactly what I did over there. I just took that printout and I just, to complete the illusion, I just cut off this little horizontal piece over here to look like this. Well, this was overlapping the piece of paper, so that when you looked at it from the correct angle, so let me get the correct angle on the camera here again. Okay, so that's the second way of doing it. Also nice and easy, hey? Just a little bit of fiddling and twiddling on the computer. And then there's another way. If you don't need a computer or anything, what you do need though is just a camera. So what you'll do then is put a piece of paper on the table and set your camera up so that you can see the actual the piece of paper. So then you put your object down on the paper. What's really important is that the object must still fit inside this bounding box formed by the paper. It can't overlap. You can't have this kind of a thing happen, because then it won't work, because now you you're going to be working off the paper. So whatever object you're doing has got to fit inside the paper. Then you don't look at this, you look at your camera. And then while you're looking at the camera, you're going to trace the outlines of this. So I'm going to keep my pencil on that outside edge. And again, it takes a little bit of practicing to do that. It looks easier than what it is, but with a bit of practice, you'll get it right. So when I do it, I just do it slowly. So all I'm doing is I'm looking at the tip of the pencil and I'm keeping it on the edge of the ball. You can see me wobbling. I think I've gone far enough to be able to see everything. I goes over there. Alrighty, so there we go. I've got it's really, really wobbly and so on. Let's take a look at it from overhead. You see, that's really wobbly and so on. But now I can just come back in. Now that I've got my basic shape, I can just define it better. But there you go, you've also got perfect distortion on that object. Okay, so now I'm going to go back to the side view because we've got detail inside that ball. Oh, look at that. Can you see it? It looks round. So now you can just see where you've made mistakes as well. So like there, I brought it in a little bit too far. So I'll push that guy out until he's round. Here, I want you to notice, can you see there's quite a bit of a like a dent over there. Let's go to look at that overhead view. Can you see it's not particularly pronounced over here? And that's just simply because of that. Because this thing is so elongated, little mistakes can be quite prominent. So needless to say, this little trick over here is only going to work for things that you can, small objects, because you need to have your, unless you've got, you can project your camera image onto a screen near you, then you can do any size. Because otherwise, you're limited by the length of your arm, distance away from the camera, because you need to be able to see nicely inside the camera's little viewfinder. Okay, so now I've got that, but I've still got detail inside the, I'm gonna just move that camera slightly up so that we can get both in the image. So let's do, say, yeah, that looks interesting. Let's do say that. Now again, I'm judging whatever I'm seeing here, but I'm looking in here. So ignore your paper fully. So that seems to be start around, just get these guys two heights to be the same. So that if you draw a horizontal line across there like that, then it's easy for you to judge the the position. So it seems to start around there. Down, up. Great. Okay, so I'll just continue this little piece around here. Seem to come quite close. Run pretty much parallel, and then it seems to disappear out of view around there somewhere. Okay, so I'm going to just draw it in solid. Okay, so let's see, what does that look like from overhead? So that's actually what I've been drawing. This weird oval. But that's what I've been seeing. And that's what the in-viewer will see at the end of the day. All right, so let's take two minutes and quickly paint that guy in. And then we've got two that we can compare from, one using the grid and one just using the camera. We can compare the two to see what the difference in what they look like. So let's just pop our ball. Our ball was something like that, eh? That's roughly what we need to paint. So I just need to get the colors in the correct places. So now, as you're painting this, needless to say, the more realistic you can paint, the better. But you don't have to. It's not a requirement that your final artwork looks realistic. But it does help, obviously, with the illusion. You can literally trick somebody's eye into thinking they're seeing something real, and then when they move, then the illusion is broken. And that's where that all comes in. It's like, oh my goodness, how did they do that? Okay, so we know our sunlight is coming from the top right. So just popping in a little bit of white over there. Top right area. Fade that away. Now we can do the green. I'm not 100% sure how that little guy over there is also going to distort his thickness and so on. So for now, I'm looking at it from the top, so I'm not too concerned about him. When we look at him from the correct angle, then we'll adjust that. So I'll pop that over there. Okay, so let's see, as this ball cools down away from us, he's going to go darker. So let's get a little bit of Payne's gray into the mix. So that bottom edge there would be darker, like that. And I think there was maybe just a little bit of that purple with a reddish color peeping out in that area over there. So I just took the red and a bit of Payne's gray in it just to darken that up. All right, let's add ourselves a bit of a shadow. So just use a bit of Payne's gray. And now you can even continue that illusion. I've now added a shadow in over here. You could just as well have put that shadow in over there to make it look like this ball is in the air, to really get a an even stronger illusion. All right, let's look at him from the correct viewing angle. Yeah, there we go. There's our ball. Seems to be something like that. So if I look at that white bit, what we've got seems to be okay over here. And then it does just go a little bit broader. Over there like that. Alrighty. So let's cut this guy. Let's grab a scissors. And I'm going to cut him straight across. So what you can do to make sure that you get that straight across correct is to just lay down a ruler. And just draw yourself a line. Sorry for all the funny angles. So that you end up with that. So let's take a look at him from the side. Let's just get our angle correct again. Way like that. There you go. Now you've got your ball standing on the table on a piece of paper. So now by rights, you could cut out all that paper. It doesn't have to stand on paper. You could cut away that paper, it would still, your illusion would still be correct. And if you paint this like really realistic, it would look like a real thing. Okay, let's go back to overhead. And let's just compare those guys over there. So obviously they are now different sizes. They did end up different sizes. But I think you can see that the type of elongation that's happening over there was also happening over there. So the the whole little system that the guys figured out way back more than 100 years ago was 100% correct. So it was quite interesting. Great fun creating little illusions like that. Alrighty guys, so I hope you enjoyed today's class. I'll see you next time. Cheerio.